Morning, Harvest. Welcome to the wonderful winter wonderland of Chicago in April. My goodness, it was beautiful though. It was totally annoying, but this morning was very beautiful. It's funny, on Thursday, the leadership team that oversees the church now, and I'm on that team, we got a bunch of little tulips and pansies. And we got in our car and we drove to every single campus. Went down to Aurora, went down downtown to Cathedral, went to every single campus and delivered them to every one of our staff just to encourage them, kind of fresh off of Easter, you know, new things and a nice little, you know, spring flower and everything. And we put a verse on there, Hosea 6:3, that says, "Let's press on to know the Lord. His going out is as sure as the dawn. He will come to us as the showers, as the spring rains, to water in season." And it was completely wrong. We should have changed it. He will come to us as the spring flurries and as the spring snow to water us in season. It's crazy, but it's the reality of living here. So looking forward to being with you. We're going to be in Colossians. You can open up your Bibles, Colossians 3. And I've had a chance to preach a couple lessons in this Colossians 3 series. The series is called Satisfied. We have had a great time, I think, in this passage. And the other two times I preached about Colossians, I did an applicable intro to kind of like frame up where we're going to go. And in those intros, I one week showed a picture of my son Brian in his football uniform and used that to kind of set up the stage for where we were headed. And then the next time I had JT in his soldier uniform from Afghanistan. Anybody remember seeing those pictures? Well, I got no intro like that today and no pictures of any of my family. But instead, we're going to get it live. A couple family members, Caitlin Bradshaw, stand up, and Michael Bradshaw, stand up. Come on. There you go. So you don't get a cool intro, and you don't get cool pictures of my kids, but you get them live. So that's my intro. So Colossians 3, 15 to 17 intro, check. All right? So we are going to just review a little bit because we've had a little break in between our time in Colossians. As you remember, we had Pastor Chip Ingram last week for Easter, and the week before we had Gene Apple. Great sermons, great preaching, but we weren't in Colossians. So we got to do a little bit of review just to make sure we're all on the same page before we go forward. So if you have your Bibles, look at Colossians 3. Verse 1 there kind of sets us up. If then you have been raised with Christ. So this whole thing is, if God has opened your eyes to see that you need him, and you've turned from your faith and embraced Jesus Christ by faith, and you've been raised from death and sin to new life in Jesus, everything that follows now is going to be about how to live that new life, all right? So he starts over there. Let me go to verse 2. You can see there it says, set your minds on things that are above. That's the first, if we're going to be new in Jesus, first thing we got to do is we got to set our minds on him and the things that are above. Then what else do we got there? You can look down. Look at verse 3. For you have died and your life is hidden with us in Christ. All right? So all of this is setting up. Then he goes to verse 5 and he starts to talk about now that you're new, you got to put to death some of these old ways of living. We all used to do these things and you got to put them to death. Not just not do them anymore, you have to slay them because they're powerful. All right? So he goes through a bunch of lists on that. Then he talks about how we're supposed to be new, different, and we're being renewed in verse 10. You have put on the new self, that's when you've received Jesus, but you're still being renewed. You're not just like Jesus when you accept him, are you? You're not even like Jesus even at the end, but you progress. Once you come to know Jesus, God shows us through his word and through fellowship, we get more like Jesus, and that's what it says there in verse 10. Then we go to verse 12. And that's what our last time was on. Putting on Christ was the name of it for part one. We're going to putting on Christ part two. But we went to verse 12. Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved. And then he goes through all these things. And we talked about this. When you come to know Jesus, he gives you a whole new set of clothes in your heart's closet. And those new clothes we have to put on. It doesn't just naturally happen. Every day when we get up, we have choices. We can put on our old clothes, which is up there in verse 5 or 6 where he goes about all those bad things that we got to change. You can still wear those. We try to put them to death, but unfortunately they sneak back into our closet sometimes. Sometimes we're cranky. Sometimes we gossip. Sometimes we do some of those old things. But when we come to Christ, he gives us a whole new set of clothes that are awesome, all the things that look like Jesus, and we have that ability and power to put them on and to live like it. That's where we were. That's where we left off. We actually left off in verse 14. And above all these, put on love, get dressed up in love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. We ended the last time with saying that love binds all of the virtues together and binds all of the virtue givers together. That love is the greatest thing. He says, above all, put on love. But you can see in the next verse, verse 15, Paul, like, it seems like he gets to the mountaintop and he says, and above all this, put on love. But what does he say next? What's the next word? And, right? So he's like, love is the greatest, but let me tell you some more. And that's where we're going today. So let me just pray and then we'll get going on putting on Christ part two. Father, we thank you for the scripture. I pray that for all of us, this section from Colossians 3, 1 to 17 will always be special to us. I pray that we always be able to go to it, to encourage our hearts, and to be able to share it with others. God, so as we study it today, I pray that it would take deep root in my heart and everyone's heart that's listening. God, that we would be able to be encouraged and strengthened and filled with joy and a heart's desire to do the things that you've called us to do, to experience the things you call us to experience. So God, as I preach today, God, I pray that your words would go forth, God. Just guard the lips of my mouth and may it be all for you, that you would be glorified and the people would be blessed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So the title is Putting on Christ, Part 2. So we're going to start in verse 15, and our first point is, be governed by the peace of Christ. So let's read it together. And, so you can see that it's connected, and let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. So let's start. We already talked about the word and, so it shows you you're connected to what was above. And then the next word says let. I like that word here. Why? Because what let is saying, what God is saying through the scriptures, Holy Spirit telling Paul to write letter, it's not like before where he says, put on. He's saying let. This is so like an appeal. It's submission. It's surrender. It's yielding. God is making an appeal through Paul here. Revelation 3:20, Jesus says, I stand at the door and what? Knock. He's not forcing his way into anything, and he's not forcing peace into your life in verse 15. He's appealing to you and saying, I've got peace. I am peace, and I'm offering you the opportunity to receive it. Some of us here today have had peace knocking on their door for a while. And for some reason, we maybe have not opened that door. And God wants you to have this. This is one of his most special gifts he can give to you. I believe it's one of the greatest earthly gifts. Love got us to heaven. He loved us and he sent his son. He demonstrated his love towards us while we yet sinners, Christ died for us. But peace is the greatest gift that we get on earth. Why? One of the greatest. We're not going to need peace when we get to heaven, are we? Because it is peaceful. There's nothing, there's no issues in heaven, but is there some issues right now in this world? Do we have a mess that we live in? We're dealing with sin. We're dealing with all of our own sin. We're dealing with the world. We're dealing with Satan. The world is a mess, and God says, I can give you something amazing if you open the door and let it in. So, and let the peace of Christ. Let's talk about what peace means. That's the next part, the peace. I looked it up in encyclopedia.com. It's funny, my parents were in the first service, and I had an encyclopedia set, actually all the books. And when I was in school, when I was young, I'd actually open up the encyclopedias. nobody would have like Encyclopedia Britannica. They must be out of business unless they somehow got online, because everything you need now is online. So I looked up peace in encyclopedia.com, and here's what it said. First, it talked about the Hebrew word shalom, one of the most really powerful words in Hebrew, shalom. And we'll talk a little bit about what that means. And then the Greek word was eirene. And here's what eirene means. It's really a deep word that has a lot of robust meaning. And here's the thing that encyclopedia.com said about eirene, the Greek word for peace. It connotates or includes the ideas of, this is from Encyclopedia, so listen to all this, totality, completeness, success, fulfillment, wholeness, harmony, security, and well-being. God wants each one of us to have that. Totality, completeness, success, fulfillment, wholeness, harmony, security, and well-being. Wow. How would you love to have a life filled with that and continually have that in your heart? But that's what God wants for us. That's what we're going for today. That's what we hope we can learn through the scriptures today. We would have that because that's what he wants. And if he wants it, can it be attained? Can it be attained? Can you have this? Yes or no? Yes. Yes, you can. Who's the giver? You can see it there. Let the peace of, say the word, Christ. Christ is the giver. You guys know this. The wonderful counselor, the prince of? That's right. That's one of his names. He's going to bring complete peace to this world someday, but he's also offering peace inside. Externally, yes. We will see that day. It is coming. But internally, immediate and now. John 14:27, Jesus is talking to the disciples and he said he's going to leave. But he says, I'm going to send to you the counselor, the Holy Spirit. And then the next line after he says that, he says, I will leave you my, guess what the word is, peace. Peace I give to you, not as the world gives, because the world's peace is no war, calmness of chaos. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about this internal, total totality and completeness and this security that comes from only what he can give you. This Holy Spirit is our peace. So he's both the author of it and the giver of it. And let the peace of Christ, and next is the word rule. It's interesting, he changes illustrations. God, through the Spirit, tells Paul to change illustrations. The illustration was clothes. Now it becomes athletic contest, because this word rule, it's like barbare is the word. And that was the word given to the head judge or the arbitrator or the referee of an athletic, like Olympic contest. That's what he's now saying. Like that guy runs the games, making sure everything is fair, making sure everybody follows the rules. That guy also was in charge of giving out the awards. They had one guy in charge of it all. And God is saying to the Corinthians, excuse me, not the Corinthians, the Colossians, and he's saying to us that peace should rule our hearts like a good referee. Nothing goes on in the games except that the referee lets it happen and he makes sure that it's fair. And you can come underneath the authority, be governed, as our point says, by peace. That's what he wants. That's what he wants for us, both in our actions and as we deal with life experiences. He's governing both the external and the internal by his Spirit. Are we letting his peace rule? That's the question for us. If we're going to get super applicational, are we going to let Christ's peace rule in our hearts? And here's five things that fight for rule in our hearts. You guys will know these. Number one, probably the number one competition to rule our hearts instead of peace is worry and fear. Philippians 4 is really clear about that. We'll talk about that in a minute. But worry and fear. Your circumstances drive what you feel. That's the world's way. If things are going great, I feel peace. If things are going bad, I feel unsettled. That's the world's way. That's not being ruled by the peace of Christ. Here's the second thing. Greed. I'm not going to be at peace if I'm desiring more, if I want something else, if I'm coveting, if I want more money, if I want more power, if I want more pleasure, if I want. I'm not letting rule my heart peace. I'm letting greed rule my heart. Here's a third thing that competes or that fights for rule. Self-pity. Self-pity. This is woe is me. The trial is so great and I'm so unfairly treated. I can't believe this happened. I'm mad at God. I'm mad at that person that did this. I am a victim. There's no peace in that if you will let self-pity rule. Next is busyness. Probably one of the biggest challenges of our age and where we live. Busyness fights for rule. No rest. Always saying yes to everything. One more thing. It's okay. I'll add it in. I run around the world for my kids. I'll maybe get church in on the weekend if I can. We'll go crazy. Every recital, lessons. Think about that a lot as a family. I'm past that stage, but it was a pressure when I was back, when I had five, from 16 down to like six. I remember those days. It fights for peace. And then last thing is thanklessness. We'll talk about that in a minute. Here's the reality. God wants us to live in peace. And the peace comes from His Holy Spirit. We talked about that from John 14. The Holy Spirit, when these things come up, and they're going to, put those five things back up there. When these five things come up and the other things you could add to the list, they're going to tempt you to be at unrest. But if peace is ruling your heart, the counselor that the peace is, the Holy Spirit, the counselor will speak to you and give you the insight and the direction on how to maintain peace. With worry, Philippians 4 says you should what? Don't be anxious for everything, but by prayer. So the Holy Spirit counsels you and says, pray. Don't be worried. Next. What's the next thing? Greed. Write down 1 Timothy 6. It's a better reference for this point. 1 Timothy 6, 17 to 19, if you're taking notes. 1 Timothy 6, 17, 19 talks about rich people and that they should be very careful for wanting more, but they should be, what is the opposite of being greedy? It's being, starts with a G, generous. The Holy Spirit, the peace of your heart, will tell you when the greed starts to creep in, He'll say, just be generous. And if you honor that, peace. Third thing, self-pity. James 1:2 says, consider it all what? Joy when you experience various trials. All right? But a lot of times we start to feel, oh, woe is me because I'm dealing with MS. Why did you give me MS, God? I'm so such a victim. I can't do this. I can't do that. I can't do this. I can't do that. Oh, my gosh. Instead, wow, what a blessing. I can empathize better with people. God's taken away something to make me rely on Him more. Wow, God, how You've used this in my life. Joy. Not happiness about it. I wish I could dunk a basketball, even though I didn't do it that much before I was. But you see, the counselor, the Spirit of peace, directly helps you in temptation. And you do those things, and peace just fills your heart. But the other two, busyness, Matthew 11, 28, come to me, all you weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in spirit, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Okay? The answer to busyness is to allow the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of peace to counsel you to make sure that you get the rest that you need. Otherwise, you're going to be unsettled. You're going to be overwhelmed. You're going to be discouraged. That's called doing it in your own strength. Last thing is thanklessness, and we're going to talk about that at the end. So be governed by the peace of Christ. I said it before, but the gift of peace may be one of the greatest gifts that God gives us for earthly endurance. And so what do we need to do? Well, let's keep going there. Let's just look at the scriptures. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body. I love this. So as each one of us holds on to the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of peace, we have peace, and now God uses that to build peace among the corporate body. It's not just individual. It's corporate. I'm so thankful and proud of this body in the middle of a difficult season. The way this body has bonded together in peace. We've had some people leave the church over some of the things we're dealing with, but I'm telling you, the people that are here, you're like, I just know, I've talked to so many of you. I don't know what's going to happen, but I love Jesus. Our church loves Jesus. I love the people I'm doing it with. What is it going to look like? I don't know, but we're going to do this thing together. And that is a supernatural gift, because God's done something in your heart first, and then you're sharing it together, and then collectively, God builds us in unity in one body. But the first work happens individually, and then it's spread to the body. That's beautiful. That's powerful. And we're experiencing it here. We need to keep praying for that for other campuses, because not everybody's where we're at. And that's okay. God works in different ways at different times. All right. So what's the application? You just need, if you don't have it, remember, he's knocking. You just have to ask God, come in. Come in, Jesus. Come in, Spirit of Peace. Come in. And believe me, he will take root. And then be attentive and responsive to the referee when you have these temptations that come. And listen to his direction and respond like a good competitor does, stays within the rules, and you'll find that you'll have what you need. All right, so that's the first point. Be governed by the peace of Christ. Here's the second point. Be grounded in the word of Christ. Be grounded in the word of Christ. I want to get a drink of water here. I went a little long on the first service, so I'm trying to be a little sharper. I'm learning. I haven't preached in a long time. And I just love talking, so I could go on forever. All right. Be grounded in the word of Christ, verse 16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. See the first word there in 16. What's the word? Say it out loud. Let. Here it is again. Invitation. He's not forcing his way into your heart. If you choose not to do these things, he feels sad because he loves you, but he's not forcing you to do this. Let the word of Christ. Well, what does it mean when it says the word of Christ? What it means, the word of Christ, it means every single word, every single sentence, every single paragraph, every single chapter, every single book, every story, every parable, every promise, every command, every warning, the word of Christ. John 1:1 says, in the beginning, the word was with God, and the word was God. Who is John talking about? Jesus. His name is the word of God. So this just isn't just Christ teaching in the Gospels. It's all of the word of God. And Paul is saying to the Colossians and to us, let the wholeness of Scripture, the word of Christ. What's he say next? Let the word of Christ dwell in you. He changes illustrations again. He went from clothes in verse 12 and following to verse 15. He went to athletic games. Now he's going to a home or a house and abiding. Cool how God uses clear illustrations to help us understand what he wants to teach us. So what is he saying about the Word of God here? Let the Word of Christ dwell in you. Not just read it, but it's to live in us. It's to make us home in us. It's to take residence in us. It's to abide in us, to have a constant and fixed place in my heart. Oh, how I long for that to be me. That it dwells. That when I get bumped, it comes out. When I'm discouraged, it comes to mind. When I want to give a word of encouragement to someone else, it comes to mind. Just like, just there all the time. That's what I want for you guys too. As your shepherd that cares for you, I want us to grow in this. I want us to be a body that it's dwelling in us, not just reading it and getting a check mark. God wants it to dwell, he's saying, to live in us. Think about you live in a house. Many of you, if you're not single, like by yourself, you're living with someone else. Whether you're a student, maybe college student, you live with your roommates, or if you're in a family, you have a wife and kids or whatever, whatever. The point of that is when you live with somebody, you talk to them all the time. You share your life with them. You laugh with them. You cry with them. You eat with them. You sleep with them. You struggle. You ask questions. That's what God is saying that our relationship would be like. With the Word of God. It's to be our roommate. It's to be your roommate. It isn't just to like get up at 7 tomorrow and read for 10 minutes. Not that that's part of making it a roommate, but it's to be like in the fabric of your house, of your heart. That's what I want. I want it more and more. And I hope you do too. And that's what Paul is saying here, let the Word of Christ dwell in you. But he doesn't just say that. He says a little clarifying word right after that. Let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly. And this word has two like connotations, abundance and treasure. So abundance is kind of the whole counsel of God thing. It's all of it, like I mentioned before. So that's what I love about our church. We're doing the book of Colossians, and we go chapter, we go verse by verse. Why is that good? Because then when you do that, everything that God once said gets said. Nothing gets left out. I don't sit in my office and go like, what do you think the people need to hear today? And let's just open up the Bible and point to it, and I'll preach it. You go right through the scriptures. You start with verse 1, chapter 1, and go right through to chapter 3, whatever. What's the last verse in Colossians? Chapter 4, verse 18. That's what we're going to do here. And that way God gets said everything that he once said in that passage of Scripture. That's what it's talking about with richly. It means abundance, the whole thing. But it's also talking about treasure, rich, the preciousness of it. How precious is it to you and me? John Gill, a famous pastor from the 17th century, he actually does an exposition of the Bible. You can use it for commentaries. Said this about it. He said about the Word of God, it's an invaluable mine of precious truth, all which should have a place in both preacher and hearer. May it be so for all of us. The question you should be asking is, how do I make it dwell in me? That's the question. We're an applicational church. I like to call harvest by three words. The Word applied. Application. How? Well, here's some ways. You could all come up with these, but look at these five ways. This is welcoming the Word to dwell. Here's the first thing. Read it. Sounds so simple, but it's read it. There's lots of different ways to read the Bible. How many of you signed up to read the Bible in a year through the Closer campaign thing? Raise them high. I want to see. All right, I'm good. Maybe 15, 20 of you. Great. You can go online. You get lots of different reading plans to read an Old Testament passage a day, a New Testament passage a day, and a Proverb and Psalm, and you get the whole Bible done in, whatever, 18 months or whatever. You can get lots of great plans. If you need help, see Pastor Mike or see Pastor Greg. We'll help you with some plans. All right? It is good to read the Bible, and it's good to read it cover to cover, because you get to see the totality of God's plan, Jesus, from Genesis all the way through, the thread of Jesus all the way through to Revelation. It's awesome. So read it. That's the first thing. Secondly is to study it. Study the Word of God. And there's lots of ways to study the Word of God. You should be in a small group. If you make Harvest your home and you're not in a small group, you're missing out. You're going to have a hard time making the words well if you're not getting together and talking about the Word with other people. All right? And we study the Scriptures in our small groups. You go deeper than even what you're just hearing. It's one way here. But in a small group, there's dialogue and discussion, and you can ask questions. That's great. I do a study called the 1718 series. This is, I've been doing this since Lynn Kablick, my former assistant, who has the label of being the nicest person in the entire world. I'm telling you, I'll put her up against anyone. She will win. I don't care what the referee says, Lynn is the winner. She gave me this in 2010. She gave me the books, James through Jude. And what you're doing here is on the right side of the page, I'll just show you. The right side of the page, you write out the Scriptures, and then the left side, you write what God's teaching you, 8 Scriptures a day. So I started this in 2010. I do it every day, not every day, almost every day, and I'm through 21 books. So I've written with my own hand on the right side of the page 21 books out, and on the left-hand side, for every 8 verses, I write what God's teaching me. So I have a commentary of 21 books already, and my goal is to have all 66 done. You know that, Awana people, there's 66 books in the Bible. And so I'm about a third of the way. So I figured if I did it in 9 years, a third of it, when I'm 71, I will have the entire Bible written down in my own hand and a commentary on every 8 verses all the way through. And I'm going to pass it on to my kids. I hope they read it. But that's studying it, slowing down and studying the Bible. That helps it dwell in you. Next, memorize it. Memorize the Bible. This week for me, it was Hosea 6:3 because we were going around to all the people in the church and we put that verse on the little flower pot. I wanted to memorize it, so I memorized Hosea 6:3 that I said in the beginning with the joke with the snow. But what are you doing? Because that's such a blessing because you can share it with others. And it then comes to mind when you're struggling with something. Having the Word of God in your heart is really, really cool, and it's part of dwelling. Next is meditate on it. What does it mean to meditate on the Word of God? Well, let me give you an example. John 3:16. Raise your hand if you know John 3:16. All right, good. This is how you meditate. At least how I do it. For God, you are awesome. There's only one true living God. There's no other gods in the earth. There's little small g gods, which are the things we try to put in your place. But God, forgive me for ever doing that because you are awesome. You are more than I can imagine. I can't even think about you. You're not just a higher form of man. You're completely holy, 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 which means different, different, different. I can't even imagine how awesome you are, God. But your creator, I know that. I don't even know how you could speak the world into existence. But God, thank you that you're different than me, that I can worship you. For God so loved. You so love. You don't just love, you so love. You love more than I can even imagine. Oh God, would I love like that? Do I love like that, God? How do I love my wife? How do I love my children? How do I love the people in my church? How do I love my enemies? Do I so love them like you so love me? For God so loved the world. The world. Oh my gosh. It's easy to love people that I know and that love me, but you want me to love everyone because you love everyone. That person that's shaking at their fist to you, you love him too because you love the whole world and you're desiring all men to come to know you and you're waiting patiently and you want to use me. I need to love the world like you. Help me to have that heart for people that don't know you. For God so loved the world that he gave. He gave. He sacrificed. You sacrificed, God. It was a gift. You gave me your best gift. You gave me your very self, and you hung on a cross and took all that for me. What a gift. Oh my gosh, you've given to me. I got to give to others. What am I giving to Chris? What am I giving to my church? What am I giving? How am I giving? Gosh, you're so great. Do you see what I'm doing? What am I doing? I'm doing the fourth point up there. I'm meditating on God's word. When you're driving to church today and you're looking at the snow and you're like, oh my gosh, then you go to the word and you see verses. Somebody sent me, I think Wayne, did you send me that today? Somebody sent me a verse about how the snow, because everyone's talking about the snow. In the Bible, it talks about the snow, how it blesses us. Like, there it is again. Then you start to, like, think about it and thank God for it. And it's so cool. Last thing is you share it. You share it. That's how you get it in your heart, because you're sharing it. And God encourages you, and you want more and more because God is using you to tell others. And that's what the next part of the scriptures are. Look at it here in verse 16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, then teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom. You see what's happening? If it dwells in you, now he's get ready to use it with others. You share it. You encourage other people with it. You admonish them, it says. What's admonishment mean? Warn people. And you do it with all wisdom. If you have the word of God in you, you're going to be wise. Thursday night before Good Friday, I have just felt led to talk to the other leaders of our church and give the entire Harvest Bible Chapel staff the day off, because I didn't want them to work on Good Friday. And I said anybody who works the Good Friday services, they could get a comp day. So I talked to Eddie and all the other guys, and they said, that's a great idea. So we did it. So Friday morning, I have the morning off. I'm going to go to Rolling Meadows at like 1 for the services. And all morning, I'm on my phone, texting people about work. I'm answering emails. I'm trying to think about what we need to do next. I spend the whole morning working. And my wife says, you gave everybody the day off, but all you did was work. But honey, but. Not only that, Greg, but this is such a loving way too. She wasn't like mad. She wasn't even upset. She just tells me like it is. And she says, and even when you're with me, you're either on your phone or you just got off your phone and you're not with me even when you're not on your phone. And you're out a lot of nights more than you ever have been. And I just want you to know that I'm worried about you. Okay. No more defense. So I call some guys that are in this church that love me. And I get Dr. Van Landingham, who's our theologian on staff, and I got him. He didn't come to the meeting yesterday. We had a meeting, and I got Brian there, my son. And he talked to Chris to get all the info, and that was just like come to Jesus meeting for Greg yesterday morning. The reason I'm telling you this is because we're talking about how the word of God is first dwelling in us, and then we use it to teach and admonish others. Mike Ruge, my brother, is, I had Mike in the meeting too. And Mike, we're talking about a lot of things, trying to get to some practical things, and Mike goes, I just want to share something that's on my heart. He goes, you got a lot of different roles, and you keep adding things onto your plate. Do you think it has anything to do with your arrogance? That you think you have to do everything and that you're not allowing God to even maybe, like you think you need to do it and like you're the only person? And I was like, ooh. But what I'm trying to say is the word of God is in Mike Ruge. And then we talked about Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourself. And Mike did it, and he did it. He brought the wisdom, but the wisdom wasn't in just the truth. The wisdom was in how he brought it to. He packaged it in love. Ernest was there. Ray was there. He packaged it in love and in wisdom that was easy for me to receive. There's wisdom in that. That's because the word of Christ is dwelling in Mike Ruge. And he knew what to say. He felt called to say it. The Spirit of God moved him, and he was able to bring the verse. He was able to do it in a kind and loving way. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. As iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. That is what we're going for in our Christian walk, what happened yesterday. That's what I want for all of you. And if you don't have it, if it's not dwelling in you and you have people around you that it's dwelling, get after it. That's why we're here. Coming on Sundays is great, but it's not the bullseye. Okay? It's the Word of God dwelling in you richly, and then your ability to teach and admonish others. It doesn't just stop with that. It goes on to say, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. I love this, because it's not just talking in small group. Singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, that's instructive to us. We got to be thankful for Eddie and vertical worship that fills these songs with truths. And we are learning God's truths as we're singing. And we're learning God's truths, and we're experiencing our hearts being lifted to God to give him the praise he deserves. At the same time, we're being instructed and grown in our understanding of the Word of God. It's not just, people think, I read a lot of commentaries, some people think, well, the result of the Word dwelling comes to singing. It's debatable. I think it's both that, for sure. When you understand the Word of God and it's in you, you just can't help but praise. But it's also instructive when you're singing spirit. See how it says, just doesn't say songs, spiritual songs. It's instructive and helpful as we listen to amazing songs and lift them up to the Lord. So let me just leave you with this on this point. The Word of God has given me so much clarity and hope and comfort in the middle of the season we're going through. It's been crazy in the last 4 months and the things I've been involved with, but I just have to tell you that increasingly I am in love with the Word of God because it's helped me so much. So many people in our church think if they just get some more information about what's really happening, it'll give them what they need. I'm telling you, it won't satisfy. But the Word of God helped me understand what's happening. Turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. We've got 10 more minutes. I got to get moving. Real quickly, 2 Corinthians chapter 1. So I'm feeling overwhelmed. I'm feeling burdened by all of the things that are now coming my way. So I go to the concordance. Hopefully you have a concordance in your Bible. You go to the back, or you go on your phone on an app and you put in the word burdened, like I did, because I want to find out what God has to say about people when they're burdened. And it brings me to 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8. For we do not want you to be ignorant, brothers, of the affliction we've experienced in Asia. For we were so utterly burdened beyond our strength. Ding, 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 ding. Automatically now I'm saying, that's exactly how I feel, so what's going to come next? Indeed, we felt that we had received the sentence of death. But that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises from the dead. Okay, I get it, God. Thanks for bringing clarity. I feel like I can't do this. I feel like I'm going to get swallowed under. I understand why now. He delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us. On him we have set our hope that he will deliver us again. And verse 11, which floored me, but you also must get people to start praying. It's not even just enough to rely on God. Paul's like, I got to have people praying too. Ooh, that was a new concept for me. I thought it was just like, just get close to God and everything will be fine. Well, God has instructed us to also get people praying in the middle of a really burdensome time. Bear one another's burdens, Galatians 6 says. Get other people in on it. It's not surprising it's there because it's also in other places in Scripture. Get other people helping you with your burdens. Anyway, my point is, time and time again, in the midst of a season that's chaotic and you have no idea what's happening, it's the Word of God that brings clarity. Nothing else. I can't give you the morsel that's going to help you. I can only give you the Scriptures, and that is going to satisfy. Because God knows everything. He's given us in 2 Peter 1, he says, everything as it pertains to life and godliness. I used to think it was just about godliness, how I could be a better Christian. It's also about life. It tells you about what's really happening. So go to the Scriptures. All right, let's go to our last point, or our third point. Oh my gosh, I have two more points and only a few more minutes. Be guided by the name of Christ. Verse 17. Let me get back there. Be guided by the name of Christ. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. This verse ties the entire section from Colossians 3:1 to Colossians 3:17. It's the big overarching verse. Whatever you do, what's excluded from that? Is there anything outside of that? No, it's everything. Whatever you do in word or deed, it's relational too, Adam. Whatever you do in word or deed, it's not talking about your mind now. Everything you do with people, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Whatever I do in regards to those God has placed in the proximity to my life should be done in the name of Jesus. People at work, people at my school, people in my neighborhood, people at the grocery store, people at the baseball field can listen to how I talk and how I act. And it should all shout and show who? Jesus. Everything in the name of Christ. I'm an ambassador. I don't do anything on my own accord. I do nothing. Whatever I say, I got from my King. Whatever I do on behalf of the King. I don't have anything to give but whatever the King tells me because I am an ambassador. Everything in the name of Christ. Look at this chart. This kind of sums up all of Colossians. Number one, my motive is Him. Look at verse 1 again. If then you have been raised with Christ, if God has saved you, everything else, that's your motive now. God has raised you from the dead. And because of that, I am now motivated to please and honor Him. That's my motive. My motive is Him. Number two, my mind is on Him. Look at 3:2. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things on the earth. So my mind on Him. Next, my means in Him. 3:3. I'm hidden in Christ. Because I'm in Christ, I can do these things. Apart from Him, I can do nothing. So He's the means. Don't think you got it in yourself to do these things. He's the means. He's the manner. My manner like Him. Look at verse 10. Have put on the new self which is being renewed in knowledge after the image of its creator. My manner, the what I do, is to be patterned after Him. I'm to live Him, Him through me. Obviously, verse 12, 13, all those characteristics, that's my manner. All of Jesus in and through me. And then lastly, verse 17 means my mission is Him. Oh, how I long to live out this mission increasingly more and more. Last Wednesday, I had a really, really hard day. I started meetings at 8:30. I have meetings entirely throughout the entire day, never a break. And I got done at 6:30, and I had a meeting on my way home from Elgin. 45-minute call on the phone, 6:30. I get out of my car. I am exhausted. I am just beat. Chris is gone. No one's home. I cannot wait to get in and just collapse on the couch and veg, maybe get the Cubs on and sleep. As I get out of my car, I look next door, and my neighbor's lights are on. And I had invited my neighbor on the right side, but I haven't invited my neighbor yet on the left side. And I talked to you about inviting our neighbors, and that's how excited I was. I've been praying for a long time about them coming to church and to Christ. And I'm like, oh my gosh. Are you kidding me, God? All right. So I go in and get the business card with the service times, and I get those big posters for the kids to draw, and I walk over there. Abby comes out with her little four-month-old baby, and I invite her to church and give her the posters. Little Charlie, four-year-old, comes out, and we talked for an hour and a half. Charlie, I find out from Abby that Charlie has kept every single high five project that he made last summer in the family room, and he talks about it every day, and he can't wait to go. And she's like, when can I get the registration? I got to get him signed up for high five. I'm like, come on, let's go. You know, I'm fired up about that. Then she says, well, then Chris comes home, her husband. We're all talking now in the driveway. And it's cold, by the way, and their little baby has no shirt on. But she doesn't want to go in. She wants to talk. She says, I'm thinking about getting Charlie baptized. But I'm not really sure if I should because he doesn't even know what would happen. What do you think about that? I've been thinking about asking you about that. All right, let's talk about what baptism is and what it represents. Let me share the gospel with you. So I share the gospel with her. She listens. Her husband listens. I invite them to church. I talk about how we're going to have baptism here on Sunday. I don't think they came. I didn't see them. But God's going to bring them. It's just a matter of time. I went home so fired up and so ashamed because I almost missed it. All that junk I did during the day, 8:30 to 6:30, that was nothing. The real work of ministry was when I came home and got the stupid cards and went over to my neighbor's house. That's what we're about. And yes, we have to do the hard work of ministry like I did during the day. But that's what it's about, guys. That do all, everything in the name of Jesus Christ. So how are you doing? What are you going to do this week? That shouts the name of, will you say the name of Jesus this week to somebody other than someone in your house? I hope so. Last point, be grateful for everything. Every verse, all three of these verses you see at the end of 15, and be thankful, see at the end of 16, with thankfulness in your hearts to God, and you see it at 17, giving thanks to God the Father through him. One's a command, the other ones are compliments or companions. Either way you look at it, you can't argue that the Holy Spirit wanted to make sure that we understood that thankfulness was very, very, very three times important. It's interesting in verse 15, it says, be thankful. That's like an attribute. That's a state of who you are. Be thankful. It's that who, is that your identity? Be thankful. Then it says in verse 16, give, or what does it say? Make sure it's right. With thankfulness in your hearts to God. That's attitude. So the first was attribute, identity. The second one is attitude. And the third one says giving thanks, which is action. So you have attribute, you have attitude, and action. Draw, if you want, draw a little triangle and put thanks in there and write attribute, attitude, and action. That's how robust, how full God wants us to be thankful. Early in Colossians, he says, he wants your thankfulness to be abounding. It's in every way that you think, that you talk, that you act. God wants us to have a heart of thanksgiving. It's the covering over it all. Wow. So good. Nancy Lee DeMoss said this, be thankful. God has commanded it for our good and for his glory. God's command to be thankful is not the threatening demand of a tyrant. Rather, it is the invitation of a lifetime, the opportunity to draw near to him at any moment of the day. All right. That is putting on Christ part two. Be governed by the peace of Christ. Be grounded in the word of Christ. Be guided by the name of Christ and be grateful for everything. All right. Let's close our eyes. We're going to pray. The application for point four, being grateful for everything, is right now I want you to call out to God. And I want you to give thanks. We're just going to quietly pray individually right now, and then I'll close us. But you have a lot to be thankful for, as I do too. We're thankful for Jesus. We're thankful for his word. We're thankful for his peace. We're thankful for our trials. We're thankful for the opportunity you get us to be ambassadors for you. Thank him. Oh God, you are looking down from heaven. We know that where two or three are gathered, there you are as well. And so we know that you're here, and we know that you watch, and I know that you know each of our hearts. I pray that individually and collectively, God, you would hear us giving great thanks to you for all that you've done. We can't even, I mean, we just had like, what, 45 seconds to do it? It's just a kind of a joke that we do it so quick because there's so much. But oh God, hear us. Thank you for Jesus, and for your word and your peace and all these things we just went through. Oh God, and help us to not be just thankful on Sunday, but in everything, giving thanks. Oh God, continue to give us the opportunity to let you in and give us peace and to dwell in our hearts through your word in a rich and profound and powerful way. And oh God, would we do everything in the name of Jesus? Would people know that they, when they see us or hear us talk, they would point to you? And oh God, we'd speak your name, not in fear, but with courage, because it's worth it, because we're filled with a heart of gratefulness. So God, thank you for today. Thank you for this body. Thank you for all that you're doing. We love you. In Jesus' name, we pray.